There's no more iconic record label in jazz than Blue Note Records. 75 years ago, Alfred Lion, the man on the left, decided to start a record label.
Later he was joined by Frank Wolf on the right. Both of these men were immigrants into America from Germany, escaping the Nazi regime. In going to America, Alfred was pursuing his dream, and his idea was to take the jazz of New Orleans he loved and present it in a way that he felt hadn't been done before. When they released their first record, Blue Note put out this as a press release. Blue Note records are designed to serve the uncompromising expressions of hot jazz or swing. Direct and honest hot jazz is a way of feeling, a musical and social manifestation, and Blue Note records are concerned with identifying its impulse, not its sensational and commercialized adornments. That's a notion that has been embraced by Blue Note records for the last 75 years. This was the very first album that Blue Note put out. The Blues Part 1, 2, 3 and 4 that Mead Lux Lewis recorded in its very first session with another boogie-woogie pianist, Albert Ammons. He'd seen them at the Spirituals to Swing concert held just before Christmas 1938, put on by John Hammond, featured a number of amazing blues and jazz artists. Alfred was incredibly taken by these pianists, and a few nights later he went to see them at Café Society, which had recently opened. Café Society in Lower Manhattan billed itself as the right place for the wrong kind of people. He signed these two incredible little boogie-woogie pianists up to come to the studio on the 6th of January, and they record all these sides. Here we have, nearly 75 years later, Gregory Porter, Liquid Spirit. This is an album that is a manifestation of modern day Blue Note Records. It is everything that makes Blue Note still a great record label. In the same way as Blue Note Records throughout the last 75 years, yes, they live in their own time and place, but they are imbued with a spirit from jazz and music and what is going on in the arts. This is a label that is all about uncompromising expression. One of the first people that Alfred Lion decided to work with was Sidney Bechet. He came from New Orleans. He epitomized everything about hot jazz that Alfred loved. Among the sides that he cut was Summertime, an old Gershwin song from Porgy and Bess. But it turned out to be the making of Blue Note Records. This one single became a huge seller, and it really financed the label during these early days. And we move to the beginnings of what we come to think of as Blue Note. Thelonious Monk. Jazz at one point was pop music. There was nobody more popular in the world of jazz in the late 1940s than Thelonious Monk. Idiosyncratic, some said he was mad, but this man was a genius. He produced these two albums, aptly named The Genius of Modern Music. One of the first sides he cut was Roundabout Midnight, which has become a jazz standard that people tend to call Round Midnight these days. Monk's style was bop. He developed this playing at Minton's Playhouse in New York. As he said, he didn't set out to develop a new style of playing. He played at Minton's to entertain people. One interesting thing to note about these early releases is the cover art. Paul Bacon was responsible for the early design on Blue Note Records. Paul Bacon was a gifted designer. These were album covers which represented the pinnacle of design at the time. Fans of Blue Note Records will recognize the numbers. Blue Note 1501 and 1502. These were the first two 12-inch albums that Blue Note issued. Miles Davis was in a difficult phase when he started the recordings. He was addicted to heroin, but as the sessions went on, Miles was cleaned up, and it is some of the greatest music he ever recorded. The design here is by Reed Miles, Blue Note's number one designer. This man established so much the look of Blue Note Records, clean design style, use of typography, which is integral to everything that we know and love about Blue Note. The name Art Blakey, of course, appears on the Thelonious Monk albums and the Miles Davis albums. And this album
called Art Blakey and the Jazz Messengers is known to all Blue Note fans as the Moaning Album because it features that wonderful track, this seminal jazz recording. It's one of those jazz records that even non-jazz fans would know the instant they heard it. Notice the fantastic use of typography that Reed Miles was famous for. We move from Art Blakey leading his own band to being a member of Cannonball Adderley's band. This is really Reed Miles fully getting into his stride. It's such an iconic sleeve. But it's one thing having iconic sleeve design, you've got to have the music to go with it. And this album delivers on every level. Cannonball was in Miles' sextet at the time, and this was Cannonball's opportunity to have his own name at the top of the masthead. Moving along to the incredible Jimmy Smith. This is the man that got me interested in jazz. As a teenager in the 60s, I bought some Jimmy Smith records that were on Verve. But Jimmy Smith started his career on Blue Note. And this record, in fact, came out in 1963 after he'd moved to Verve Records and became one of his biggest hits. It had soul, it had all the things that I was listening to on Tamla Motown and kind of stuff you listened to as a teenager. And this is definitely one of those worth seeking out. Dexter Gordon, tenor saxophonist, fabulous player. They talk about the big three tenors, Lester Young, Coleman Hawkins, and Ben Webster. In my book, they should always talk about the big four tenors. Dexter Gordon is up there with the very best of them. Dexter had gone to Paris, where he teamed up with Bud Powell and Kenny Clarke and Pierre Michelot and produced one of the great saxophone albums of all time. Guitarist Kenny Burrell played on the Jimmy Smith Back at the Chicken Shack album, but this is his album as a leader. As the title implies, it's an album steeped in the blues. B.B. King always said, if you played the blues, you're in high school, and if you play jazz, you're in university. I like to think this is the album that B.B. King was thinking about when he made that statement. From an album steeped in the blues, we go to one that is on the cutting edge of modern jazz. It's an album with a tragic story behind it because shortly after this was recorded, Eric Dolphy died. He had an undiagnosed case of diabetes. He died in Berlin. This is modern jazz. This is really on the edge. It's an album that you wouldn't play to somebody who was just starting out on their journey into jazz. But once you know you like jazz, you'll progress to this album very quickly. An absolute work of genius and a fitting epitaph to Eric Dolphy. Frank Wolf, Alfred Lion's partner, did the wonderful photography of the artists that were shot in the studio, but this is actually a shot by Reed Miles. He'd obviously had the brief to design a cover for Eric Dolphy's Out to Lunch. He goes out in his lunch break, sees this sign, and it's his picture. We'll be back, Out to Lunch. Herbie Hancock, a name that is synonymous with Blue Note, synonymous with jazz, somebody who's still playing today, recording, making brilliant records, but this is one of his very earliest, The Brilliant Maiden Voyage. It's very accessible, it's full of brilliant playing, and it's one of my favorite Blue Note albums, as is Song for My Father, the Horace Silver Quintet. Horace Silver, one of the stalwarts of Blue Note Records. He was there in the very early days, and he recorded right up until the late 70s when Blue Note Records was put into hibernation. This album, with the title underneath in Portuguese, because Horace Silver came from the Cape Verde Islands. And when Horace was growing up, his family would gather at the Silver House and play music and sing Portuguese songs. And this is what inspired this wonderful recording and Song for My Father, one of the quintessential Blue Note tracks. Wayne Shorter, Speak No Evil. Don Walls, the current president of Blue Note, told me that this was one of the albums that convinced him that Blue Note and jazz was something that he needed to listen to as a teenager. He said, this is an album that you can put on, listen to, and at the end of it, you know that everything is all right with the world. Wayne Shorter, another one of those geniuses who we're still lucky to have with us, with Herbie Hancock, Freddie Hubbard. One of the things to notice about Blue Note Records, they always put all the musicians on the front. It's that idea that everybody contributes to the collective brilliance of a recording. We move from the 1960s to the 1970s.
Between the recording of these two albums, Alfred Lion had sold Blue Note Records and jazz was moving on. This is an album that polarizes opinion. Some people think this is not jazz, just not the kind of thing that Blue Note should have been recording. I would disagree. It's a wonderful album. It's got vocals on it, which is another reason why purists don't necessarily think it's the sort of music that true jazz believers should be listening to. Donald Byrd and Black Byrd brought a lot of people into the jazz tent, and subsequently, he has been one of the most sampled artists on Blue Note by hip-hop. And if that polarized opinion, this certainly did.
Waited till I saw the sun.
Norah Jones, the biggest selling album in the history of Blue Note. There are people who say this is not jazz, and it probably isn't, but who cares? Norah Jones was 22 when she was signed by Bruce Lundvall, the head of the company, and insisted that she wanted to record for Blue Note. She'd grown up listening to Blue Note records. That's what inspired her to be a musician, to write wonderful songs. EMI, who was at the time the parent company of Blue Note, thought maybe she should be on another label, but no, she said, I want to be on Blue Note.
Unreroute the rivers, let the damned water beat. There's some people down the way that's thirsty, so let the liquid spirit free.
And then we move bang up to date, 2013, Gregory Porter and Liquid Spirit, Grammy-winning album. This album, for me, shows where Blue Note is today, shows where Blue Note is going tomorrow. Gregory, along with artists like Robert Glasper and Jason Moran, are forging a whole new path to uncompromising expression. We've had 75 years of Blue Note. Here's to the next 75 years.
Liquid Spirit.